All right, so the sixth generation Mustang replaces the old retro styling of the fifth gen. So the fifth gen really tried to bring back that retro modern styling, and to be honest with you, I just wasn't into it. Now, the sixth gen gets completely rid of the old frumpy front clip of the fifth gen. So with this car, the whole thing has been completely redesigned with just a much, much nicer appearance. Now, if we come over here to the side, we still have that really long belt line that we had from the fifth gen, but another part that's been really, really well done is the rear haunches. So if you come over here, you can see that they just made these hips really, really nice. It's just, oh, so nice. And then the last thing that I really want to talk about is the back end. So this back end here looks so much better than it did before. This reminds me of a Pilates instructor, just, you know, lean and athletic. However, Ford did retain the three sequential brake lights that they had before. Okay, so now this Coyote 5.0 is everything that we want in a modern engine. So there's a big difference between the 2018 and the 2017. So the 2017 had a compression ratio of 11:1, but this one bumps it up to 12:1. What that means is instead of putting out 435 horsepower, this one puts out a whopping 460 horsepower. That's insane. And not only that, but we also got 420 foot-pounds of torque. So this thing spins up like nobody's business. So the really cool thing that makes this a modern engine is we've got 32 valve, dual overhead cam with variable valve timing and direct injection plus port injection. So, you know, the intake valves don't get all gunked up. I think Ford did an amazing job with this transmission. And this one also gets a 10-speed automatic. So before you could get the 5-liter V8, you could get the 3.7-liter V6, you could also get the 2.3-liter turbo. In 2018, they took away the V6 option altogether, and the only two engine options you had were the 5-liter V8 and then the turbo 4-cylinder. So now the inside of this car is a very nice place to be as long as you're up front. Ford's styling department, I think, hit it absolutely out of the park. You definitely get a good sense of the old Mustangs from the way the whole dash is lined up, but you also get the modern convenience of the touchscreen, automatic climate control, the steering wheel feels nice. I mean, there are cheap plastics here, but you know, that's what you're gonna get in a car like this. And then one of the things Sarah was telling me about was the backlighting, right?
I agree. It's a cool mix of like the old muscle looking car with the like luxury of a sports car. There's a lot of cool backlit things. The door handles are backlit. The cup holders are backlit underneath both the driver's side and the passenger side have backlighting that you can change to, I believe, 12 different colors. Right now they're red, but they can be blue, white, green. Like it's really very customizable to whatever you want.
And another thing is the feel of the buttons and knobs. All of the buttons feel very pleasing to push and the knobs feel solid. Like there's nothing chintzy here. The Prindle is nice and meaty. The air vents work exactly as they should. The door handles feel like metal. I believe they're aluminum. I'm not sure, they might be plastic, but they feel like metal. All in all, the styling is just 10 out of 10 for me.
I agree. Gauges are cool. Like it's a really cool looking car. Like if you were first time you were to sit in here, you'd be like, wow, like this car's really neat.
Oh, now the infotainment on this car works great. Personally, with my Samsung S10e, to pair my phone, all I have to do is plug it in and it does everything exactly as I want it to. The processor is exactly what this car needs. There is no lag in telling this car to do what I want it to do. When I want my maps, I got my maps. When I got my music, I got it right there. When I want my call log, it's all right there. I cannot emphasize this enough, how manufacturers need to put the correct processor in for the infotainment system. Ford, in this one, did an outstanding job, and I have zero complaints with this head unit.
Something I like is if you do not want to plug your phone in, say you don't have a charger and your phone dies, the navigation in this system does not require a monthly service fee. It's not a membership. I could plug in an address right now, no phone connected, and it will give me directions, audio directions to wherever I need to go with a map.
Yep, Ford, hit it out of the park.
So, Sarah, when it comes to interior practicality, what would you say about this car?
I would say built for speed, not for usability.
Yeah, what do you mean?
There's no room for literally anything. I noticed there's really nowhere in this car that can fit your phone. I have an iPhone 11, which is, not the biggest phone ever, but it doesn't even fit in the one little slot below the USB port.
Okay. Well, I do want to say, I need to point out that these cup holders are pretty massive up front.
They are, and they have the little, I'm sure there's a name for it, but they have the little,
the prongs?
Yeah, the prongs, where, if you get, a big, coffee from Dunkin', it will fit in here because it can adjust, which I like. But these are the only two cup holders in the entire car.
Really? Yeah, the back seats are more shelf than
non-existent.
Seats.
It's a very nice place for a purse or backpack.
Leather place for a purse or backpack.
Yeah, so your purse or backpack is very nice in the leather seats. Unless you have friends like Lieutenant Dan, no real-sized person is going to comfortably fit back there.
Also, there are no power ports. There are no cup holders. It's really just a shelf with the place for some twigs if you have legs, and that's it. So, not the most practical of places, but it is snug, so we'll give it that. Anything else to add?
Not a place for kids, even small children.
Oh yeah, you can't fit a Carson back there.
Small children complain. My small children, who are very little, complain that their knees touch the back of the seat. There's leg room. The seat is too small. It's uncomfortable. So a small standard booster is too wide. You can barely buckle the seat. You have to lift up the booster, buckle the seat, and then set the booster back down. So not a car I would buy with children.
So in my opinion, this car is not ideal for anyone with a child of really any age, because this is a standard booster seat. It's probably one of the smaller ones you can get, and it barely fits in this seat comfortably. Barely. If your kid is any bigger than this or any smaller than this, it will not work. Another reason that it is not ideal for children is if anyone is in the passenger seat and recline back even remotely, they are going to crush this child's legs. And that's another thing. These seats don't go back past 45 degrees. This is all you got. So if you're looking to take a nap in a passenger seat, probably not in here. So let's talk about the comfortability of the car.
Okay.
Me personally, I think that the driver's seat, 8 out of 10.
Yeah.
The seats are very comfortable. The leather is really soft, but it is black leather. So the heated seats and cooling seats are an absolute necessity, especially if you're in Texas, where it gets to be about 195 degrees summer at night. You're gonna need that, or you're gonna solder your ass to this leather seat.
Yeah, black leather in the summer is a killer. So to piggyback off of Sarah, the front seats are a very nice place to be. They're leather, the leather is soft, there's good stitching, they're properly bolstered. This is a sports car, you don't want to be sliding all over the place. Both seats do have power front and back.
However, the seat backs themselves are manual. The driver's seat actually has power lumbar as well. And funny story, when I took over for Sarah the other day, she had so much lumbar on her seat that I thought she was trying to realign her spine. I was like, Jesus Christ. But other than that, it's really not bad. Keep in mind, it's a sports car, so it's not going to be the best riding. But the absolute worst place to be is the back seats. Like, if you were a human smuggler, you would feel bad for anybody sitting in back. I was only back there the other day for about 25 minutes, and my back started to hurt so bad that it took almost an entire day for me to recover from sitting in this back seat.
Unless your friends are Lieutenant Dan, there's
no, ain't got no
regular
legs.
Size person that's gonna sit back there.
No.
I am not a tall person. I am 5'1 on a good day, and I do not fit back there. My small children complain that they do not fit back there. And also, there is no regular size standard car seat of any age that will comfortably fit in that back seat. Not only are they bucket seats, but they are very narrow. And the car seats sit at an angle, which is obviously not safe.
Ideal. But yeah, another issue with the back seats is there are no head supports. So if you get rear-ended in this car and you're sitting in the back seat, it's very likely that you will get whiplash. So back seat, it ain't it, bro.
So for this review, Sarah and I decided to go on a little bit of a road trip up to Legacy Hall in Plano, Texas. A while back, I came across a place on Instagram called Buttercup Chicken Tenders, and they looked like they had the most bomb chicken tenders I'd ever seen, with a little bit of a unique twist. One nice thing about driving all the way up to Plano is we got to see all these nice views of the growing city. Now, if you've never been to Legacy Hall, it's a three-story building in Plano's Legacy West with nothing but restaurants on the bottom floor along with seating. Then on the second floor, they have more seating and a bar. Then on the third floor, there's even more seating and another bar. Guys, let me tell you, the place is legit. It basically reminds me of like a really bougie food court, and I'm definitely here for it. They've got a ton of restaurants, and there's something here for everyone. After we walked in and found Buttercup and placed our order, Sarah almost immediately got distracted.
Would I be going against the plan if I went and got a bowl of ramen?
Yep, she got some ramen. So our food was done in about 10 minutes or so, and this is what we got. Sarah and Matt got some chicken tenders and a few different types of dipping sauces, whereas I got something that Buttercup is known for, which is called the Buttercup. The Buttercup is a bunch of smaller chicken tenders and macaroni and cheese inside of a waffle cone. And we also got some of the crispy fries, which came out perfect. All of this food was great. Buttercup reminded Sarah of a really high-end Chick-fil-A, and I agree. Their food was cooked to perfection. So a big thank you to Buttercup, and now back to the review.
So, this car is fast, make no mistake about it. With 460 horsepower and 420 foot-pounds of torque, you have more than enough under your right foot to either get yourself out of trouble very quickly or into trouble very quickly.
This is definitely not a car that you would turn over to some green-ass 16-year-old that just got her driver's license.
No. If you're not careful with this car, you're either going to murder yourself or innocent bystanders. So depending on what drive mode you have selected, you will either have very soft, smooth, and uninspiring up and down shifts, or if you flip over to the track mode, you will have immediate, harsh, just brutal upshifts and downshifts, and this car will hold RPMs very high to just give you immediate throttle response, which is exactly what you want on the racetrack, but not so much what you want for people sitting in the passenger seat. This car is also incredibly planted on all four corners. When we went up to Plano the other day, and I was driving coming back, we were going around the interstate interchanges, and you could just feel the grip. I mean, I know Sarah wasn't enjoying it, but I was just there like, Jesus Christ, this thing is absolutely on rails. I mean, up front, there's a giant stabilizer bar, and in the back, you also have independent rear suspension. So there's absolutely no problem getting this car to hook up around corners. Now, with this being a sports car, you're not gonna have the smoothest ride available. While the suspension is very good for performance driving, that doesn't carry over to regular everyday driving. Your passengers aren't gonna like this car if they're expecting a smooth ride. Really, nobody is. But those same things make this car very good on the track. All things considered, you know, this isn't a car I'd want to take on a 1,200 mile road trip because of these things. That's just not what this car is meant to do. I mean, you said you drove to Laughlin with Matt, right?
I drove from Southern California to the corner of Arizona, and it was a 3-hour ride, and it was awful.
Yeah, that's just not what this car is meant to do. However, I think with the way Ford has set this car up, they have struck a good enough balance between sport tuning and ride comfort to make it manageable as a daily driver if you really enjoy this kind of car.
So we're gonna talk about visibility.
Or lack thereof.
If the top is down, amazing.
You have unlimited headroom.
Unlimited. You can see all the way around you. There are no blind spots, obviously.
Except for the A-pillars.
Little bit in the front, but not terrible.
However,
with the top up, it is like looking into the back seat and if your back seat was a closet.
It's so bad.
It's dark. You can't see anything because of the convertible. It's really, really bulky, and the window in the back is very, very small. So not great visibility.
Yeah, the convertible top just gives you this massive B or C pillar. I'm not sure what it'd be for a convertible, but it's literally like this big, and there's just no way you can see anything back there. And then the tiny rear window and the spoiler in the back. The spoiler looks badass, but it also spoils your visibility. Okay, Sarah, let's talk about safety tech. So this car is really par for the course these days. We don't have anything super technologic. For example, we don't have adaptive cruise. We don't have blind spot monitoring. We don't have lane keep assist, but we do have traction control that can be completely turned off. We do have four-wheel ABS. And the mirrors do have blind spot mirrors. Now, my thoughts on a car like this, these should all have blind spot monitoring standard. If you try to look back in this car with the top up, you cannot see anything. Like, you can easily lose a dually to the side of you without knowing anything about it. And another thing that makes me really uneasy is if you do put one of your enemies in the back seat and you end up getting rear-ended, there are no head restraints. So the back seat occupants are very likely to get whiplash. And I just don't think that's a good idea or a good design, especially on a car that costs over $50,000. And then there's something about the seatbelt you want to bring up.
So I don't know if this is, I guess, safety specifically, but it does involve the seatbelt. So I don't know if you could tell the way that the seatbelt loops through the top of the seat, but if you do not pull the seatbelt through that loop prior to getting in the car, you damn near have to dislocate your arm to reach back to the back panel to reach the seatbelt. So it's not, you know, the worst thing in the world, but it's definitely not fun.
Yeah, there is a few things they could have done better here to make this car more safe, and I really wish they had. This is not the car you buy for fuel economy. No Mustang is, not even the four-cylinder Mustang.
You buy this car to go fast, and this car does that very well. If you are interested in what we were able to achieve while we were driving, we were averaging 20 miles per gallon combined city and highway. It's not great, but it's not terrible either. If you're worried about fuel economy, buy a Civic.
Yeah, this car, if you're really stomping on it, you can essentially hear your gas mileage going down. So not the car for gas mileage or great gas mileage, but it does okay for what it's in.
You know what, Sarah? This car might not give you miles per gallon, but it does give you smiles per gallon. All right, so let's talk about the things that we like and we don't like about this car. Sarah, we'll start with you. What do you like the most about this car?
I like it's a fun car to drive.
There it is.
No ifs, ands, or buts. It is a fun car to drive. It, even by yourself, you know, you're driving down the highway, you stomp on it, it, you know, puts a smile on your face. And not only that, it is a head turner. I've had several people today alone tell me, nice car, cool car.
Yeah, this thing is just sexy, aggressive, but also classy. And personally, I can't get over the looks of this thing. I think, once again, Ford designers knocked it out of the park. When it comes to things I don't like about this car, I gotta be honest with you, the stereo sucks. It's just not very good. The back seats are garbage.
Non-existent.
Yeah, there needs to be head restraints in back for safety. That's really the only bad things I have to say about this car. Everything else is awesome. The engine and exhaust sounds fucking amazing. The transmission is great. You have line lock to heat up the tires for going to a drag strip. I mean, Ford gave you everything you want in a performance car in this package.
I feel like the convertible is a cool feature.
Love the convertible.
Me personally, I do like the look more of the hardtop because it gives you more like that old school Mustang, like American muscle feel. But it is a cool, you know, driving along the beach or, you know, in the summertime, like, you know, it's a cool feature, but just personally, I think I would have went with a hard top myself, but, you know, it's, I guess, all preference.
You know, before driving this car in a convertible, I would have agreed with you, but these past couple of days, having convertible, pretty fucking legit.
Yeah, it's very fun, it's very cool. As a girl with long hair, not that cool. Hair in a ponytail or get a hard top.
Yep. Well, anyways, everybody, thank you so much for watching our video, and we can't wait to see the next one.
Like and subscribe.
Peace.